So I'm thrilled this morning to introduce our keynote speaker, Lindsey Pollak. Lindsey is a New York Times bestselling author. She's an international speaker, globally recognized career and workplace expert. She's often called a generational translator. She just asked me what generation I was from. I'm not sure. She is frequently cited as the leading voice in generational diversity at work. Her speaking audiences and consulting clients include more than 300 of the world's top corporations, law firms, and universities. Aetna, Estee Lauder, GE, Goldman Sachs, Google, Harvard, MIT, Stanford, you name it. She's the author of 4 career workplace advice books, including The Remix, How to Lead and Succeed in Multigenerational Workplace. Her insights have appeared on numerous media outlets, The Today Show, Wall Street Journal, and we are so lucky to have her here. She's based in New York City. She's a graduate of Yale University, and Lindsey credits her passion for generational diversity to her college days as an RA in the dorm. Let's give her a true women leaders welcome. Lindsey Pollak to the stage.
Perfect song. Heather, thank you so much for that very kind introduction. I'm so happy to be with all of you today. I first started working with women leaders back in 2017. Patty Phillips has been such a friend and advocate, and she is not just a friend and advocate for women leaders in sport. She is a friend and advocate to women authors and speakers, and I deeply appreciate that support. One of my favorite things about the topic of generational diversity is that everybody is a leader and everybody is an expert because we are all members of multi-generational families. We're all members of multi-generational cities and towns. So we're going to talk today about how to get better at optimizing all of the different generations that surround us. We're going to start with the very big picture and work down to what you can do today. So this is the big picture. Last time I spoke with all of you, there were 4 generations in the workplace. Now there are 5 generations in the workplace. The traditionalists, the baby boomers, Generation X, millennials, and Generation Z. And we are not a 5-generation workplace because young people keep coming in. Those of you who work on college campuses know that happens every year. We are a 5-generation workplace because people are working longer and later into their careers. So I told you what my favorite thing is about generational diversity. This is my least favorite thing, which is whenever you talk about generations, there is always some stereotyping and some criticism. And what I find kind of funny after studying this for 20 years is that we do this again and again to every new generation. So if you're a baby boomer, you were probably told that you would never live up to the glory and the honor of the World War II greatest generation, and you were wearing jeans and your hair was too long. If you are a Gen Xer like me, you were called a slacker. You were designed as the baby bust after the baby boom, and we were all living in Seattle, drinking black coffee and listening to grunge music. If you are a millennial, where are my millennials in the room, millennials? Congratulations, you are a member of the most stereotyped and criticized generation in human history. It was hard to pick which magazine cover to show to get all of the criticisms in one, so I picked this cover from Time Magazine, which says, "The me generation. Millennials are lazy, entitled narcissists who still live with their parents." I think it's just missing that you want trophies for participation. The joke, of course, as you know, is on Time Magazine because you don't read print media, so you never saw this cover. And now we have the new 5th generation in the workforce, Generation Z, and we're going to talk a lot today about the pandemic and the impact. If you remember back to March 2020, one of the first groups that we blamed for spreading COVID was the college kids on spring break. In Florida, we immediately blame the youngest generation. We do this again and again and again. So take a look at this quotation. "I see no hope for the future of our people if they are dependent on the frivolous youth of today." Could be from this morning's Wall Street Journal. What do you think? Baby boomer era? The flappers in the 1920s? Revolutionary period? This is from the 8th century BC. We've literally been shaming young people for all of human history. We do. My thesis today is generational diversity is not a problem to solve, a challenge to overcome. It's an opportunity to optimize. And I believe now more than ever that the organizations and the individuals who are able to work with and thrive across all generations in the workforce will win. And the organizations that refuse to change, to adapt to any of the generations, will not succeed in the diverse workforce that we find ourselves. And Carla Harris spoke so beautifully yesterday about so many of the challenges in the workplace and the great resignation. And the numbers are clear. Yes, younger people are more likely to change jobs and leave organizations. But I don't want to talk about where they're leaving and resigning from. What I'm interested in is where they're going to. And they're going to go to places that respect them and respect all of the generations at work. That's our goal today. So I've already thrown a lot of words around. Heather doesn't know what generation she is. We have to solve that problem. So here is the math portion of the session. I will talk you through this slide. And by the way, the slides will be in your conference app after today if you would like to access them. These are the five, now six generations in the United States. These numbers look a little bit differently around the world, but I'm going to stick to North American definitions. We start with the traditionalists, World War II generation, very small generation. Generational size tends to follow the economy. Tough economic times, smaller generation. After the traditionalist comes the baby boomer generation. No generation will ever be as large as the baby boomers. It's hard to even fathom how much the boomers have defined the world of work and culture for roughly the past half century. Look how much bigger that number is. Boomers are enormous. Gen Xers come back after that. There's a pendulum swing to a smaller generation. Then we have the millennials, another large generation, but not quite as big as the boomers. We have Generation Z, again, a smallish generation. And now we were not very smart in the demographic field. We started with Gen X, so we very, very quickly ran out of letters of the alphabet. And so now we have moved on to Generation Alpha, who are kids roughly 10 years old and younger. So when you look at a chart like this, there are a couple things I want to point out. First is, these big groups of 15 to 18 years are starting to feel irrelevant, that someone 18 years old would have anything in common with a baby born today. Things are just moving too quickly. In China, they talk about children of the 80s, children of the 90s. I think we're moving towards that. And one of the ways I'm seeing that play out is groups have broken off and form what we call micro cohorts. And these include Generation Jones, which is the younger baby boomers who aren't quite Gen Xers. The name comes from keeping up with the Joneses. I was 3 years old at Woodstock. I wasn't part of the summer of love. I didn't get the spoils of being a baby boomer. That's how Gen Jones feels. Maybe you identify with Xennial, starting with an X. Xennials are the younger Gen Xers, older millennials who feel like they kind of have one foot in each generation. The mark of a Xennial, also known as a geriatric millennial, I don't make up the names, I just report them, is that your favorite video game growing up was Oregon Trail. So if that, I see some identification. It's not Roblox, it's not Fortnite, it's not massive multiplayer games. You pressed two buttons and got dysentery and that was your idea of fun, yes? I see you. You're a Xennial. So micro cohorts are coming up. I also want to point out one of the reasons people are talking more about generational diversity now than they have in the past is not just that we have the five gens in the workforce, it's also we're at a point of kind of equality among the boomers, the Xers, the millennials, and the Zs, about 20% of each. We're going to see this play out, I think, in the next presidential election, that every age cohort is going to be important. But none of this, to me, is as important as these numbers right here. I could joke all day about Oregon Trail and Justin Bieber and Reality Bites. But to me, and for all of you in your roles, what I think is most important and relevant is not when somebody was born, it's when they started to work. What was their experience on their first day on the job? I was born in the 70s, but I started work in the 90s. The rise of Silicon Valley entrepreneurship, the dot-com era, email. All of that, I think, influences how I work and see the world and what my expectations are than when I was born. So when you look at the people on your team, what technology was given to them on their first day of work? What percentage of leaders were women and people of color when they started out? And how does that compare to the other people? That's where I want to focus our attention. But first, I thought it would be fun to see who we have in this room of women leaders. So I'd like you to applaud when I name your generation. I want you to applaud for the generation that you feel, which may not correspond with the one you actually are. And I also want you to feel free to just lie. Okay, so do we have any traditionalists in the room? Applause, traditionalists. Anybody whose career was heavily influenced by a traditionalist leader? For sure, a lot of that is still being felt. Baby boomers. Jen Jones. Ladies and gentlemen, Heather has identified officially as a Jen Jones, breaking news. Thank you. Generation X, where are my Gen Xers? Congratulations, that's the most applause we've ever gotten in our lives. So, yay, Gen X. Only Gen Xers get that joke. Zennials, anyone identify as a Zennial? Millennials. Gen Z Swifties. Where are my Swifties? Or should I say my Kansas City Chief Travis Kelce fans? Anyone have a Gen Alpha child? Gen Alpha child. Why did I even put Gen Alpha on this chart? What was Gen Alpha's first experience of work? They've already had it. It was watching you work from home. Or go to work because you were deemed an essential worker. Many of our feelings about work are based on our parents' experiences in the workplace. That's where Gen Alpha is gonna come in. Let's look at these numbers a little differently. This is now the workplace. That was all of society. This is the workplace over roughly the past 25 years. This is how we got to five generations and why it's so unique. When I started my career in the 90s, there were three generations. Traditionalists were the oldest in the workforce. They were primarily retiring out at age 62, 65 because 70% or more of them had a pension. Baby boomers were at the height of their career. When baby boomers were at the height of their career in the 90s, there were more of them working than any other generation has ever been born. That's how big those boomers are, and you can extrapolate back. Gen Xers were starting out. We had people at the beginning, the middle, and the end of our careers. It was a nice, easy story. So as a Gen Xer, it made sense that we would adapt our communication style and our career expectations to the boomers, because they were the biggest. And we thought, well, eventually it'll be our turn. And 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 if you can see there, I'm gonna try to get close. For about 15 minutes in 2013, can you see that? Gen Xers were the largest generation in the workforce, and then bam, millennials came right up and we had to pivot. If you are a Gen Xer, you have a superpower, and that superpower is you're bilingual. You can speak boomer, and you can speak millennial. Now we have five generations in the workforce. There are still traditionalists working today. We have more Americans over the age of 85 in the workforce today than ever before in history. Think of the debates we're having about politics and age. Five generations in the workforce. When you walk into a meeting, when you dial into a Zoom call, when you walk into a conference room, you have no idea who has the longest tenure. You have no idea who the leader in that room is. You could be sitting next to someone 40 or 50 years older or younger than you, and you have to adapt to that situation. We've never done this before. So I ask you to think about, in your work environment, the people you deal with on an everyday basis. If you're on a campus, it's probably all five. Who are the people in your red circle, and what do those generations look like? I also, of course, want to mention intersectionality. We cannot pull age out from all aspects of identity. The goal of today is not for you to walk up to your colleagues and say, how old are you?
and decide how to treat them. My experience as a white, cisgender Gen Xer is different than somebody else's. Generations are one factor of identity, but why I think they're so important in the workplace is because they give us clues to two things: what experiences people have likely had or not had, and what expectations they bring to work. We are more alike as humans than we are different. That's why I always talk about families when I start. But our expectations are different. And the analogy I want to share with you is the way we feel when we meet people from different countries. You might meet an athletic director from France or an athletic director from Japan. You have a lot in common. You know your job, but you know you might need to speak a different language to communicate with them. There might be different etiquette that you need to follow. But what's important is you don't judge it as better or worse, good or bad, right or wrong. It's just different. Would you agree that the United States of 2023 is a different country than the United States of 1955? We start in different eras. I would argue that the United States of February 2020 is a different country than the United States of today. That's a helpful analogy. So the way I'd like you to think about your own career as a leader is to be what the technology entrepreneur Gina Pell coined the term perennial. I can't take credit, but I try to be a perennial. You can't change the age that you are. But what you can do is decide to take on two challenges. Number one is to know and share your history. What was it like before? I thought of this a lot with the recent inflation rates. Right? Some of us have been through periods of inflation before. We've seen it. We can talk about what we did. Others haven't. Know your share your history. And number two, keep up with the times. You can honor your history and keep up with the times. I think of an architect I worked with who knew how to design with a pencil and paper. But in the 1980s, everyone started using CAD design software. He said, "Of course I use CAD, but I teach my students how to use a pencil and paper so they have that tool in their toolkit." Be a perennial. So if we all have to be perennials, we have to know our history and know what's happening now. So I want to share with you a series of data points to place us in this moment in time and see just how much has changed. Gender in the workplace is equal in a lot of organizations and schools now. It certainly wasn't not that long ago. Racial and ethnic diversity, Gen Alpha, who are referred to on this list as post-Gen Z, will be the first majority non-white generation in American history. That is a massive demographic turning point. Young people will expect, as Carla mentioned yesterday, their organizations to reflect the world that they have seen around them for their entire lives. LGBTQ plus identification has doubled just from the millennial to Gen Z change. Yes, I think people are reporting their identity more than they may have in the past. This may be a reporting issue, but that is a massive change, and we're seeing the results of that in the media and in issues facing the sports world. Now let's take a turn and look at licensed drivers in the United States of America. How many of you, like me, got your driver's license the minute you turned 16? Why? Freedom, independence. If that was so important to us, why would young people today be getting their driver's license at half the rate of the 1980s? Uber and Lyft, gas is expensive, fossil fuels, parents give them rides places, all of that has a factor. But what's the real reason? You no longer have to leave your house to be social. You no longer have to leave your bedroom to date, to work, to play esports, to study. You can be free and express yourself through your phone. How many of you have little kids at home? Kids at home? Sending to their room is no longer a punishment, am I right? That is the command center of all entertainment. Why would you leave home to do anything? What this means is if you hire a young person who is a younger millennial or a Gen Z, they have literally spent thousands of fewer hours talking to other human beings face to face than any other generation in human history. They've spent less time talking to other people than any generation in human history. I do not say that as a criticism, because nobody asked to be born into the generation they were born into. One millennial said to me, we didn't ask for participation trophies. Adults kept giving them to us. Nobody has ever said to me in 20 years that young people aren't smart. What they say is they don't seem to know how to connect with me. They don't seem to know how to talk to people on the phone, how to handle situations. I think this has a lot to do with it. And I draw a lot on the work of Dr. Jean Twenge out of the University of San Diego. Some of you may be familiar with her work. When you look at the statistics, the smartphone basically changed everything. What she says is the arrival of the smartphone has radically changed every aspect of teenagers' lives, from the nature of their social interactions to their mental health. The trend appears among teens poor and rich, every ethnic background, in cities, suburbs, and small towns where there are cell towers, there are teens living their lives on their smartphones. This is where work starts to play a critical role. Because people are spending more time in virtual spaces, they're spending less time in IRL, in real life spaces, and that affects what I call community belonging. Church memberships are down. The chart on the right is people who say, I have no religion. Not about spirituality, but I don't belong to any religion. In the traditionalist era, it was about 18% of people said, I don't identify with any group, and now it's about 50% of Generation Z. Membership in Rotary clubs, memberships in Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts troops, memberships in professional associations, people who say they talk to their neighbors, all of that is down. I believe it is a human need to connect. People are trying to do it online, but when they don't belong to any other organization, where are people looking for connection and community? At work. And so, while it may not be fair, the burden is on you to create community, purpose, belonging, identity at work. We can view that as a burden, or in my opinion, you can view that as an opportunity. Because if you are creating a community, if you are creating trust, if you are creating connection, you will retain a disconnected generation. It is certainly more prevalent among young people, but it is happening across all five generations. The other ramification of smartphones, of course, relates to mental health. I don't need to tell a room full of people in higher education about the mental health crisis in this country. The younger you are, the more likely you are to report signs of anxiety, loneliness, depression, and otherwise exacerbated by those intersectional factors. I speak on a lot of college campuses, and they have told me, the administrators, that high school guidance counselors are calling colleges to say, you need to know what's coming. And colleges are calling employers and saying, you need to know what's coming. The expectation among young people is they will find mental health support in the communities that they trust, which is increasingly their schools, their teams, and their work environments. Doesn't mean every leader has to be a therapist, but I'm starting to hear the term mental health first aid being thrown around, which is that someone on a team, someone in a department needs to be the go-to person for this very, very important issue. I want to end the data slides with, of course, technology. And when I talk about technology, I don't want to talk about the actual technology itself. It's how it changes experiences and expectation. So I'm going to start on the far side with the fax machine. Does everybody know what a fax machine is? Okay. So, if you remember, fax machines were often very large devices that would be in the middle of a busy office. So I had a client who was a lawyer. She was an older generation Xer. She started her career in the very early 1990s, before the days of email and certainly before the days of cell phones. And she said to me, I feel sorry for young people today who don't get to send faxes. I saw some love here at the front table for faxes, so I feel like you relate to that. And I said, you're going to have to explain that to me. And here's what she said. She said, when I first started my career, one of my jobs was to fax contracts to our clients. And if you remember, those of you fax lovers, this was the experience of sending a fax. Boop, 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 boop. And it would take hours to send a large document. What What this woman said to me was, while I was standing in this busy law firm sending faxes in the days before email, everybody around me was on the phone. And I would overhear conversations. And they would be negotiating. And they would be chit-chatting. And they would be having difficult conversations. And they would be managing conflict. And they would be giving people directions. And for hours and hours and hours a day without anyone teaching me, I would just hear how to communicate. Number two, she said, I was standing there sending faxes, people would walk by and they would chat with me and we would get to know each other and we would build relationships, not because we planned a coffee Zoom date, but because we would just walk by each other. It was networking, it was relationship building. Third, she said, when nobody was talking on the phone and nobody was coming and talking to me, I didn't really have anything to do, I didn't have a cell phone in my pocket, so I read every page that I faxed. I had hours and hours of learning and reading time. I learned how to communicate. I made relationships, and I learned about my industry. Now, how do we send a contract? All of that is gone, and we don't realize it's gone. Some of you may be feeling, nobody taught me this stuff. I just figured it out for myself. No, you didn't. It was happening all around you. And because of the lack of technology, nobody had to teach you because you were able to pick it up. Now we have to be so much more deliberate, as I'll talk about in a moment, about making up for what is lost with the change in technology. Fast forward to 2003 and LinkedIn. I have a special LinkedIn offer for you at the end of the presentation. What LinkedIn changes is how we feel about our jobs. My first job was at Working Woman magazine. Anybody remember Working Woman magazine in the 1990s? And I went to work, and I liked it. Went home, went back the next day. Now, you can go to work and like it, go home, log into LinkedIn, and say, oh, gosh, all these women and women leaders, they got to do a second line last night. Maybe I should apply for a job there. And, oh, so-and-so just got promoted, and she has a higher title than I do, and that company looks cooler than my company, and she gets to work from home one day a week. And you are now competing with every other job in the universe, possibly being better than your job. That's what LinkedIn does. It creates that FOMO, that fear of missing out, that something might be better, the grass might be greener. And then look ahead to what we've all been through with the pandemic, working from home or needing to go into work when things were dangerous. If you've had that experience, you will never forget what that was like. I think there is a cohort of those who started their careers in 2020, 2021, 2022, who will never be the same from having that experience. How are they adapting to your culture? How are they communicating? That's a really unique group. And now generative AI, ChatGPT. Once that technology exists, people are going to use it. I was at a financial services client recently, and I was working with the leaders, and I said this, and I said, you know, how are you handling this? And they said, oh, our employees don't use ChatGPT. And I said, oh, really? And then I did a focus group with their employees, and I said, how many of you are using ChatGPT at work? And guess how many raised their hand? All of them. Once the technology exists, we have to show what to do about it. So all of this data is to say, in the words of Voltaire, common sense is not common. How I use technology, how I interact in the workplace might be very different from somebody who started work in a different era. We can't assume that anybody works or sees the world the way that we do. So, what do we do about it? We've talked about the big picture. Let's get down to what you can do, whatever your role, whatever your organization, whatever your generation. I talked about being a perennial. The second tip for all of you is to be what I call a remixer. I wrote a book in 2019. You can find it in the Women Leaders store called The Remix. I came up with this title, based, of course, on remix songs. And we all know what remix songs are. You take a classic, excellent, successful song, and you do not say, that song should really retire. That song has been around a long time. No, you say, that's an amazing, great song. But there's so many modern things that could happen. Maybe we could do something else with it. Maybe we could create something new. And I didn't want to name a book The Remix without talking to some people in the music industry. So I interviewed some producers and DJs to ask about remixes. And one DJ told me that when she plays a wedding, which is almost always a multi-generational event, she said, when the dance floor is empty, I always play a remix. Because the older people at the wedding recognize the classic part of the song, and they feel included and come and dance. And the younger people recognize the remix version, and they feel included, and everybody is dancing together. That is how I think we can address generational diversity. And we're going to talk about it in four key areas: recruiting, career development, communication, and culture. We start with recruiting. Whether you are in a recruiting role or not, we know that it is harder than ever to find great talent. This was the struggle of a particular pool and beach community in Galveston, Texas, that could not find teenagers to be lifeguards for their pools and beaches. Finally, somebody said, why are we only assuming that teenagers would want to be lifeguards? When you look around the pool, it's mostly people over 55 who like to swim because it's a low-impact exercise. Maybe if people get certified, we could have lifeguards of different ages. So they placed ads where? In the newspaper, and recruited lifeguards across all generations to work at their pool and beaches. The key benefit, they said, of having multi-generational lifeguards is that the older lifeguards could give rides to the younger lifeguards who didn't have their driver's licenses. Who might you be overlooking in your recruiting? Maybe it's people of a certain age. Why does an entry-level job have to be a young person? Why does a junior job have to be somebody right out of high school or college? Many companies now are rethinking whether a job requires a bachelor's degree. Companies like Google and Ernst & Young and Accenture are saying, if you have the skills and can do the job, we don't require that credential. Many hospitals are rethinking their rules about tattoo visibility. The Mayo Clinic used to require that anyone in a clinical role had to cover or not have any visible tattoos. They started to run out of millennials to hire because 41% of millennials have a tattoo compared to 13% of baby boomers. They started to relax the rules. And what they noticed in customer or patient responses to their clinical staff is that patients who had tattoos felt more comfortable because the staff had tattoos, and it was a win-win for all. Parents of potential employees. Many young people have close relationships with their parents. In the Rust Belt, in the Midwest, this was hurting manufacturing companies because parents were telling their kids not to apply for factory jobs. They thought they were dirty. They thought they didn't pay well. And the companies realized they had to change the thinking of the boomer and Xer parents who had stereotypes in their mind about what it meant to work in a factory, which is very different today. So they started hosting events for parents to come to educate them and invite them for their children to apply for jobs. I mentioned FOMO and how LinkedIn causes that people are leaving jobs. A lot of companies are rethinking their feelings about former employees. If somebody left your organization on good terms in an appropriate way, would you consider keeping in touch with them, maybe in a LinkedIn group or having some alumni picnics, and inviting them to come back at some point in their careers, which today might be 40, 50, 60 years? Many companies used to have the philosophy, and perhaps some of yours still do, that if you leave, you are dead to me. That seems short-sighted when people might have longer career tenures. And do you know who your most loyal net promoting employees are? The ones who left because they thought the grass was greener, they saw that it wasn't, and they came back and will tell everybody it's really good here. We call them boomerangers. Let's look at employee benefits. Are your employee benefits speaking to all generations? PricewaterhouseCoopers PwC had what they thought was a gold standard employee benefit. They offered a 401k match. Then they looked at the data, and their millennials and Gen Zs were not taking the match. And I imagine in my head there was some sort of big high-level meeting and somebody said, well, that's because they're lazy, entitled narcissists who don't care about their personal finances. And then I imagine someone else at the meeting said, maybe we should ask them. And when they asked millennials and Gen Zs why they were not putting money towards their retirement, where, my millennial and Gen Z friends, did they say they had to put their money instead? To their student loans. PwC became the first large company in America, now it's almost a third, who give employees a choice. We will either match your 401k retirement savings or your student loan payment, or both. By the way, it's not just the students, it's the parents and the grandparents who are helping their kids with college who are also taking the match. Remixer rule number one, don't think either or, think and. How can we offer more choices to serve more generations? Remix number two is career development. I was on an airplane a few years ago. Never tell anyone what you do on an airplane. And this young guy said to me, I'm so glad that you work with millennials. Can I get some coaching? And he said, I'm an ambitious millennial. I want to get promoted fast. And my boss keeps telling me, slow your roll. Your career is a marathon, not a sprint. And he said, I said to my boss, okay, if my career is a marathon, what mile am I on and how fast am I going? Because nobody is telling me. We don't talk to people about their careers. We make assumptions that they know what it takes to get ahead, and we make assumptions that we know what they want. Why are millennials and Gen Zs so eager to move forward, to get promoted fast? They don't have some chip that the rest of us don't. It's what they have grown up seeing. In 2010, Mark Zuckerberg, founder of Facebook, becomes Time's Person of the Year at age 26. A little bit later, Greta Thunberg, age 16. People are succeeding younger and younger, and we see that, and it puts pressure on young people to want to move forward fast. Many people don't necessarily want to get promoted. They want to do something completely different. Instead of ladder career paths like many people followed in X and boomer and traditionalist eras, we now have more of a lattice model. People might want to move sideways. Don't assume that a young person wants to move forward fast. Some don't. Don't assume that somebody in their 70s wants to slow down. Some don't. So what do? We ask the question. I'm seeing a trend called stay conversations, which is not a promise, it's just a transparent conversation to say, let's talk about your career. I want to make sure I know what you want. I want to make sure you know what is available to you in this organization. The idea of a stay interview is it replaces an exit interview. Because how often have you had an exit interview with somebody you really wanted to keep? And you said, why are you leaving? And they said, well, I really want to go and do X. And you said, you could have done that here. And what do they say? Nobody ever told me that. Stay conversations. What most people want is to improve, to develop, to get better. Every chart I've shown you has been kind of a straight line up or a straight line down all over the map. This is the one chart where almost every generation wants the same thing. I'll read it to you. This is a percentage of each generation who view an employer's professional development and training as an important consideration when applying for a job. Everybody wants to learn and grow. Young people want so much feedback. They want feedback all the time. I would have loved feedback when I started out, but nobody gave it. Once you start giving feedback, everybody wants it. So how do you do that in a very, very busy world? I'm a lifelong fan of the 1 Minute Manager. Came out in 1982. Any 1 Minute Manager fans in the room? 1982, global bestseller. This doesn't need to take a lot of time. Feedback doesn't have to be a full 360. Feedback is 1 minute catching somebody doing something right and calling it out. I love how you did X. Feedback is 1 minute of here's something you could do a little bit better. And I would add, given the mental health crisis and challenges of the pandemic, I would add 1 minute of how are you? How are things? How's your stress level? That's it. You can do this by phone, you can do this by text, you can do this in person, you can do this over Zoom. This can be a text message on Monday morning. It doesn't have to take a lot of time, but it has to be done. I'm also a big fan of reverse mentoring, which is another remix. Mentoring is fantastic, but I think it's limiting because mentoring is the idea that there is some Yoda on a mountain who will give you advice about how to run your entire career. I don't think that's possible anymore. Things are changing too fast. And if you don't have a mentor, you feel bad that you're missing that. Why not find micro-mentoring everywhere and from everybody? And I think all of us need a mentor who's not just older and more experienced, but one who's younger and less experienced. We call that reverse mentoring. Fabrizio Freda, the CEO of Estee Lauder Companies, had his entire management team of 250 executives around the world each pick a reverse mentor who is a junior person with less than 2 years' experience on their team. Once a quarter, the junior person takes the senior executive shopping for makeup. Best job ever. Because what could be more important to the leaders of Estee Lauder Companies than understanding how a 20-something person buys makeup? Reverse mentoring is so powerful. You don't have time to do that? I know a baby boomer who every week says to the Gen Zs on his team, hey, you guys, put a new app on my phone. I want to see what you're using. Why do we have to listen to young people? Why do we have to give so much feedback? Nobody did that for us. Because the world has changed. Because every time you log into Amazon, what did you think of your last purchase? Every time you eat at a restaurant, what did you think? I was in the bathroom at the airport walking out. How was your experience? It was fine. So if the whole world is telling you that, you expect that your boss, who's supposed to care about you, is going to be telling you those things too. Rule number two, never assume, ask, and then listen to the answers. I worked with a CEO who was so resistant to this. Nobody did this for me. Wouldn't have a reverse mentor. I said, would you have a breakfast with your Gen Z employees? He said, fine, but I'm doing it at 7 a.m. And I said, fine. They showed up. Afterwards, I said, how did it go? He said, it was horrible. I hated it. They had so many ideas for me, and the worst part, a lot of them were good. Number three, communication. Most people say that this is where they feel generational differences the most. It feels like we're speaking different languages. So the antidote, talk about how you talk. Communicate about how you communicate. I had the pleasure of speaking to several members in the room of all generations before this talk, and Gloria Navarez of Mountain West told me that when she started her new role, she sat down her team and said, okay, this is when we email. This is when we use Slack. This is when you text me. And you only call me if it's a life or death situation, and I will always answer the phone. I will know that we have previously agreed that that is when you use my cell phone. All you have to do is talk about it. Do you have any pet peeves people should avoid? Can they use ChatGPT or can't they? Be clear about how to communicate. It is an act of generosity as a leader to tell people how to reach you. If you are an employee, become a detective on how your leader communicates and adapt accordingly. Now, when you do set these rules, be specific and define your terms. I worked with a company in Chicago that said the real problem with our young people, Lindsey, is they are abusing our PTO policy, our paid time off policy. And I said, may I see the policy? The policy said, take an appropriate amount of time in PTO. What does early mean to you? What does fast mean to you? What does better mean to you? Define your terms. People are afraid to be clear on their remote and flexible policies. Employees report they would rather you made a policy that they despise than not having a policy at all. Clear is kind, because people know how to respond. And finally, let's talk about culture. I think people ask too little of their employees. Invite every generation to have a seat at the table. If you are planning an event, if you are deciding on what volunteer effort to do, if you are decorating the office, you are planning something that is supposed to be fun. I can't tell you how many clients say, Lindsey, we want to plan a fun activity for our millennials and Gen Z. What should we do? And I say, have you asked them? They will tell you. Invite people to be part of the multigenerational culture that you are creating, because everybody wants to feel that sense of belonging. The final piece of the puzzle is something that Carla talked about yesterday so beautifully as well. It's the why. 69% of employees across all generations say that they will be loyal to companies that make them feel a sense of purpose, that they are doing their work for a bigger cause. In 2015, KPMG was listed at the bottom of the big four accounting and consulting firms in their competitive set when it came to employee satisfaction. And so, to work on this issue, they created something called the Purpose Project. And they asked every employee across KPMG, what is the purpose of your work? The woman on the end, I keep jobs in the USA, she was a junior employee who spent all day in Excel spreadsheets. And she said, I could talk about how I use Excel formulas all day long and sit in front of my screen, but the numbers that I am working with are related to tax credits for people who create jobs in our country. When I think about that, I feel more motivated to do my job. They put posters up all over the office, they put this all over their social media, and importantly, individual managers and leaders, when they started meetings with their teams, said, what is the purpose of this meeting? Go over the budget numbers, sure, but what's the purpose? Why are we really here? The year that KPMG implemented the Purpose Project, they went from number 4 in their competitive set in employee satisfaction in the Fortune 100 Best Companies to Work For list to number 1. By reminding people of their purpose. Remixer rule number 4, focus on the why. I loved Carla Harris's statement that Xers and Boomers were told jump and we said how high. Millennials and Zs ask why. Everybody wants to know why. We just didn't expect it. It's an expectation for young people. It is a joy and a thrill for those who are older. So I said I would bring this back to you today. Here is your homework assignment today. Talk to someone of a different generation. Talk about their why. Talk about their experience. Have some reverse mentoring in the room. I mentioned that I'm very active on LinkedIn. I would love to continue the conversation there. I also have an online course called Managing a Multigenerational Team. If you follow me on LinkedIn, my post today is a thank you to women leaders in sports, and you will all have access to that course for free. We'll put a link in the social media as well. I'm really unhappy with my hair in the video, but otherwise I really hope that you enjoy it. Thank you to Patty Phillips and the incredible team at Women Leaders in Sports. Thank you to all of you for the work that you do. And I know that you are not all millennials, but I wanted to offer you a trophy for participating in this session this morning. Thank you very much. Thank you. I'm unstoppable.